left from home a long time ago. They were just roaming hippies, ready for next disaster. But then they joined, and the prince said, he took my son. What do you mean? Your son was already a junkie out there, you know, spooking around. What he took? You know, he took what you missed. But they were like, they get in the bloodline. Very important. My son. What do you mean, your son? There is no son. There is no daughter, really. We are all just similarly karmically affiliated beings accumulated in these so-called families. And there is definitely a genetic similarity, very strong one, but still it doesn't define the soul. It's the soul has just came into that situation, being, Prabhupada called it family, he called it enlarged, false ego. This I am the I am, and then this we are, that's the next thing. And then when you enlarge the family even more, then it's we are the nation. You know, this is all extended for his ego, nothing to do with the identity of the soul. And that also is demonstrated to us how selfishly the family members can be, even to each other. Everybody conducts the lives on their own terms. That's the frustration of paranoid, really. Every parent sooner or later gets frustrated, you know. But it can be used, the line. Like I yesterday showed this devotee is constructing a temple, and practically 99.9% of the people on this planet are Shudras. So Shudras, they get affiliated by work, you know. Oh, you work? Well, I know how to work like this too, you know, and that you can use. So normally, like the father of a devotee would never get an idea to be involved in the construction of a temple. Why should he be involved? He said, you know. But then he's always becoming a devotee, getting involved in construction of the temple. He immediately comes around, especially in these countries, like Eastern countries, it's like that. Oh, I can do that, I can do that. I can do that. Now he thinks he's making a door or a cupboard, but actually he's engaged in devotional service. Already then. And they don't mind that later on there will be a Jagannath on the altar. They already have Jagannath, this is so huge, you know, and they don't mind. They think, oh, that's, how did he carve that? Because he's a carpenter. How did they make this music? What kind of musical instrument is that? You know, yeah. My father, he would be actually not interested in Krishna consciousness, but as soon as somebody plays Veena, then he would be interested because it's a string instrument. You know, the drums that's for him like from Africa, you know, Aborigines. He doesn't understand the subtleties, even actually it's quite a subtle instrument. But string, anything but the strings, okay? Okay, okay, okay. That starts to get interesting. You know, it's so simple. Shudras are so simple. I know how to do it. I have the tools. I can carve that. And then it will be a monument of my work. It will stand here. And all people will come and say, wow, who did this? And he goes, that's my Shudra father, he did that. And I will go, ah, horse nasak. You know, this is how you manage with children. So people are like that. And this is fully encouraged in Krishna consciousness. You know, a gardener is a gardener, a carpenter is a carpenter. Everybody is what he actually can be. This is so nice in Krishna consciousness. You don't have to be anything else as what you can be. The problem is that this shastra is facilitating so many identities. It is a universal scripture addressing, you know, who is a brahmana, who is a shudra, who is a kshatriya, who is vaishya, addressing all the aspects of life, ashramastu, brahmachari, grihastha, vanaprastha, sannyas. So where are we all in it? How do we find ourselves in it? Therefore, we have a guru, shastra, and sadhu. And sadhu and guru are gardening, so we don't get the shastra wrong. Not wrong in an essential understanding, but improper. You know, it's like you can study medicine, like in a hospital. But when you look in a detail in a hospital, oh, it's very refined and defined types of medicine. Nowadays it's so complicated. medical studies are just, right, you can study forever, you know, just for tooth. He's a dentist, it's a lifelong study of dentist. Or he is studying the neurologist, how the nerves work in the body. Then he is studying, you know, being a chirurg, how to cut the body open and put it together again. He is studying about this, he is studying about chronic diseases, he is studying about tropical diseases, he is studying about this. There's so much specialization in these things. But they are all in a hospital. They are all in a hospital. And in a hospital, they also divide the patients. They don't put a man with a broken leg into the department for tropical diseases. You know, why should they do that? He has a broken leg. That's all. Besides a broken leg, you don't have to even stay in the hospital. They fix it and put you home. Because why should you occupy a place? This is a disease which can be treated at home. They put the gyps and go home. But then there's diseases which require, you know, a very refined observation and treatment, and they have departments for that and all this. Similarly, in Krishna consciousness, it's far more subtle as what meets the eye. People think we are all standing in a kirtan, singing the same, eating the same, chanting the same, but it's not the same. That's the basis. And this is what Prabhupada said. In a kirtan, yes. There is no varna, there is no ashrama, there is nothing. Kirtan means kirtan. There is no shudra chanting, there is no vaishya chanting, there is no kshatriya chanting. Actually, it is. You can hear it. But, you know, but it doesn't matter. Prabhupada, that's the place where we are all the same. You chant Hare Krishna in front of the deities, kirtan, that's the same. That's where we should meet. But as soon as that stops, and we go about our individual duties, there, sooner or later, the water finds its level, and birds of the same feather flock together. Unavoidable. And it's such a power on it, you cannot avoid it. You'll be drawn into that association. You will be fond of doing something, hopefully, being steady and stabilized on a level you can continue Krishna consciousness, say, for the rest of your life. Why not? Rest of a life is not a bad concept in that sense. Because the stability, which sometimes turns into routine, that's a problem. And routine means imperfect. To be stable and keeps personal focus means that actually you really understand Krishna as a person. Because then you can be stable and steady. Yes, I will serve Krishna all the time like this. It's like when you love somebody, you don't mind to do the same thing for him over and over again, because the activity in itself is not the real kick you get, you know, it's not really the social inspiration. It's the person you are serving. You know, that's the important part. It's the eating part.
Yeah, it's somebody is watching for the water.
Yeah, of course, it's the sound system. It's
at least we can now something.
At least it's getting more evident what the problem would be. You know, so I don't want to give a lecture here, but we could maybe pray if somebody has a connection to Srimad Patrick, to pray that we get in touch with the same gentleman that's going to install it. They will come and tell them, look, this is the problem. You told us you are eating experts. Why do we even just check this? Because this is a hammering of one. This is always the something, stuck in something. So the water has to go. So empty out the whole thing. Give it a smooth flow. Then you don't have that. This is an interesting sound. Nice, but your nature always reveals ultimately this is the problem. Like you die. This is the revelation. This is the problem. It's happening here. And then it doesn't happen anymore because it broke. Finished. Throw it away. This is not your nature. But we don't want to always come to that point. We want to maybe be prevented. So anyway. So material nature is assigned like this. And Narada Muni is amazing. He's like the master of the ceremonies in Srimad Bhagavatam. He's like the red lion going to the Bhagavatam, introducing the stories. And he sees the whole Bhagavatam like a display. It's amazing. Narada Muni always appears with a mic on his screen. He goes, and here comes the next number, you know, and here we have Hiranyaksha. And hello, you know, like this. He's like introducing. It's amazing. You know, he is like the lion which goes through the whole thing. Amazing personality. And, you know, he has this amazing also freedom coming along with that position of being the master of the ceremonies, because he can go in the material world, in the spiritual world, back again like this. You know, he can just travel. And just in the case that he is he's demonstrating how transcendental he is in all regards, he never touched the ground, you know. He's always off the ground and goes now in the material world and giving the demon speaking, and what do you want? I want to kill Krishna, very nice. And then he goes over there. Sometimes he goes to Kamsa and goes, I am not sure, you know, the promise given to you is right. Maybe you should kill the children faster, just to speed up Kamsa's karma, you know, just to bring him more closer to destruction. And Kamsa goes, yes, Narada Muni. And he's actually this amazing thing, Narada Muni. Everybody trusts him. He can speak to a demon. They go, yes, yes, you are right, yes, yes. You know. And then he goes to the devotees and they go, yes, you are right. You know, he can go like this. It's amazing. Amazing person. So it is here shown once again that in a preaching field you can use, Prabhupada used it with parents. He said, oh, you are such a nice person because you gave birth to such a nice son. Look what a nice devotee he is. And they were like, well, I didn't came here for that. I came here to complain that my son is a devotee, and I get praised that my son is a devotee. Prabhupada was due to his age. He really, he praised the children. Such a nice child. If you want to please the parents, you have to please the children. Even the child sometimes really, you know, a rascal. You know, to say, oh, such a nice child. Oh, so nice. You know, in Sankirtan, you know, you just go, ee, and the baby, and then you have the book. You know, and they go, yeah, yeah, from a, you know, from a nice mother comes a nice baby, you know, and then you take the book. And, I mean, Sankirtan devotees are full of these techniques. You know, you praise people, you know, like, that's what Prabhupada gives us a formula for preaching. Like, yes, sir, you are so full of knowledge. You're so powerful. You are so effulgent. You have so many wonderful abilities. Amazing. If you could just for a few seconds forget the whole thing and take a book, you know, take the message and watch it in your mouth. Even one Mataji, I remember, she demonstrates on the street. She always approached Kamas because it was her nature. So, you know, she grabbed the man on her arm and she was going, we have muscles. With a strong arm. The man was like, I mean, it's strange, you walk on the street and suddenly a woman appears. But she had this kind of charisma on her. She looked like a half a man, you know. She was like, Germans like it. You know, men like it sometimes too. Especially demons like it. They like men with the men, who they can challenge, catch, and break down. You know, it's a challenge. They're like sporting the men. They created the whole feminism just to let them come out and bring them, ah, I'm free! And they go, okay, let's have a chase. Let's see who is more free here. You know, demons like this kind of taste of the chase. So she just went to the man, strong arm. Can you hold a book? You know, and she gave a book. And he was like, strong arm, strong man, holding a book. And then, of course, it was just a very short scene to translate this into this, that the strong man who has a big book, he can hold a book. He can also pay for it, he's not so poor, isn't it? You know, just completely addressing his false ego, strong all the time. If I would do it as a man, he would punch me in the nose, you know. he will feel so insulted and so challenged. But of course, when a woman does such a thing, men go like, oh, man, of course I can pay for it. He's asking what a level of distribution. Just distributing, not to the soul, distributing to the false ego, that's all. But if it works, why not? Anything can be used just to transmit Krishna consciousness. And that's what Narayana is doing. The expert preacher, he knows. He knows exactly where the Prabhupada has this amazing way to kindly and humbly make you to do exactly what he wanted you to do. That's called manipulation, yeah. But for Krishna, no problem. For material purpose, this is very simple. This is called brainwashing, this is called, you know, all kinds of things, taking advantage. But because the devotee is free from the mentality to derive benefit from others, he has the right to do this. And Krishna and Narayana, they are doing it themselves. Some questions? Yeah.
It can seem like in the Vedic society, in the Vedic society, that people would always respect, you spoke a lot about respect, so people would always respect the governance, the purity, but as you also mentioned, like, today it's more like you respect your own vana. If you're on that level, you respect that. A sutra will respect one for age and etc.
Yeah, that's borderline consciousness.
Mm-hmm. So is that something like that should be changed in Islam, or is it just, okay, that's how we are?
Change, it can be changed very much. It's all one of the biggest diseases that we even don't practice that. We expect others to practice it, but we don't practice that. We are the always the movement of the chicken movement. You know, we don't respect the head. We always respect the behind where the eggs come from. You know what I'm talking about. You think, what's the use? Figure out the head. And here comes the egg. The egg is always making noise, and it's picking, eating, I have to get the grains, I have to maintain the head of the chicken. Let's cut off the head and keep the behind. That's where the eggs come from. So it's prayer and shreya. We are always interested in an instant, momentarily benefit and result. Never in long-term thing. That's called moral goodness. So for this movement, it's a movement anymore of passion. I'm saying it now because I don't care. This is an international society for passion. Come in! Do it! Build it! You know, we did it! Let's build it up! Let's make it! We need money! Money! Let's get some money! And then, you know, after some years, we have the leftovers. It's called senior Vaishnava. You know, that's like, okay, can you still make some money? Join! So as Swami used to call it, the Iskon dupe. You know, it's like a dupe. Stuff it in one way and then out it goes to the other end. The other end. I don't want to speak about it anymore, I guess, because every devotee who joins this movement is nowadays much faster as an idea as we used to do. It's amazing how Krishna works. Because devotees nowadays, they are confronted with the Iskon. You know, the other side of the tube. They can see, hey, this is too salty. I come in front and where is the back? In the back they found this, you know, this you know, I collected for this temple for 20 years. You know, it's a great preaching. They think, what happens to me after 20 years? this is all modes of nature. So Swami used to say, if you walk in more of a passion, what do you expect? But then there's another concept of mode of goodness. We don't do anything. We just go deeper and deeper and deeper in Krishna consciousness. So deep that you can just put a lid on it and that's it. You know, it's just like a very deep, deep, deep tunnel. You can do this. This is not the Sankirtan movement. Sankirtan movements, yes, we do spread it. But we didn't manage to make the connection between the young Yadavas and the old Yadavas. They were not preachers, they were kshatriyas. And the combination is absolutely essential. Because then you can just go to the old guys, you know, that is all like very deep. It's so deep that nothing happens. You know. And when you have the young ones, they say all kinds of activity, no brain. There's no brain. The same mistakes are made, the same things are repeated. No brain. Because young means usually no brain. That's good. That's good. And they climb the trees, sit on the branches, everybody has a fresh, brand new soul and goes. You think, hey, I was sitting on that branch too, you know. If you keep on cutting enthusiastic like this, you will fall down, including the branch. But you don't know. An old guy. Blong. Ah, we have so many broken branches and so many broken trees. So this is a point which so many older devotees struggle with. Say, yeah, I somehow are at least. Yeah. Not only I'm speaking about Krishna consciousness and senior devotees, I'm speaking about common sense and brain. Like, you know, I like the Japanese Vaishya spirit. You know, it's quite fierce. Japanese capitalism is just really, you eat after competition, just like if you eat cherries for the breakfast. You know, just eat them all up. As soon as they bankrupt a big company, the first thing they do, I heard, they hire the boss for good money. They say, hey, you are finished now anyway. We finished you off. So you work for us. Why? You just sit here and tell us, what did you really do wrong so we could take over you like that? Just please, keep on talking. What happened in your company? In a great detail. It's the same thing with hackers. With hackers, you know, computer hackers, it became so popular that the hackers already know that probably I will get caught sooner or later. Nowadays they have a pretty sophisticated system how to trace down a hacker. But let me be caught with something very sophisticated. Like example, I will break into the Bank of America, you know, ship $2 million around and see what they will do. Sooner or later there will be your door knocked out and there's this guy with his head you know? And he goes, okay, I made it. Why? Well, they will give you two options. You go in jail for a very long time. Or the bank goes, you drop all the charges, keep him, he works for us. For good money, because good money, that makes people very stable. You know? And he said, you just sit in this bank and make our infinite security here. Because how did you grow up in the dog sink? You know, you must be good. So, please, you know, work for us. This is intelligence, material intelligence. How did this movement start? By somebody who was collecting lots of money? No, he was penniless. Somebody who could run the whole day, possibly collect money. He couldn't. He needed even a stick to walk. By somebody who was very expert in everything? No, he wasn't. He knew how to find expert people. And that's called Srila Prabhupada. We don't understand. This could be applied in our lives too, isn't it? We cannot draw from people. We are not resourceful. Why? Because we are Shudra. Shudra is good, boom, money, good. No money, more boom, boom. No money, after my also boom, 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 money, thank you. Just like that. He doesn't even understand what is happening. He wants only the money at the end. It's not only a movement anymore, a passion, it's a Shudra movement. So much for Brahmanic culture. Because the Brahmanas I know and I can testify and demonstrate throughout their life, their own Brahmanic nature, they are all around. They give you names and addresses. I shouldn't speak like this, isn't it? I'm a new devotee. The older ones usually, they are not so upset. They know. We have Brahmanas walking around doing the most ridiculous things just to survive. While the Shudras and Vaishyas have a good time. Shudras because you say, I can walk and eat good, good movement. Here's some work, here's some food. And they tell me I'm a Brahmana. That's on top of that. It's a good deal. I can eat, I can work, I can learn some shloka, and I'm only giving lectures. Shri Mahashudra Uvacha. And the Brahmanas are supposed to sit there like idiots and listen. They will not do that. Not because they're actually proud, because it's boring. It's damn boring. It's not inspiring. To listen always, the Mahashudra. As Prabhupada used the example, you put a Shudra on a, you put a dog on a roller seat, as soon as the bone is flying, he will come down. Oh, that's very inspiring, Krishna consciousness collecting bones. So we are not facilitating the Brahmanas. The Brahmanas are underground, writing, trying to seek any opportunity they can preach. But the Brahmanas also have a problem. Brahmanas are becoming a melancholic introvert. Brahmanas should go out and find something that they can do what they have to do. Brahmana is not just some kind of guy who just watches from the window and goes, it should be like that. Then he closes the window and studies again. Brahmana is somebody who goes out, because he knows if I want to change something and do something here, I have to go on the street and find people. That's what Prabhupada did. He meant it really when he said, I couldn't do anything without you. In technical sense, it's true. In a spiritual sense, that's another thing. He knew how we are much we are depending on it. So he went out and found people to do things, which he found very useful to do, which he knew he has to do, because that was the instruction from the spiritual master. That he found his chalas. Very fierce ones. Krishna sent him. Kshatriya is not so easy to please them. It's not so easy to control either. You have to be very, very charismatic, very, very convincing. So that he had come to tell them out. Well, I can give you names. He had them all out there. This was people. Who loved that? The Prabhupada said, go out and do it.
It's impossible.
Prabhupada looked like, impossible is a word in a fool's dictionary. Don't you think you are, you're so small.